So I wanted to come on here. Thank you for joining me. I wanted to come on here. I have my own podcast called Introverted Girl Show. This is not about my show, but this is the platform that I'm choosing to do this on instead of my platform, because I've been seeing a lot of misinformation, especially regarding what happened to Cheslie Kryst. And it's very disheartening, especially for this family that is going through this tragic situation, and people are spreading misinformation and rumors about her, and she can't defend herself anymore. So I wanted to come on this platform. I did not want to make a video because I just didn't want to make a video about this, but seeing everything on YouTube that's going on right now, people, I don't know if they're using it for views or likes. I don't know what it is. That's not what I'm here for. I'm here to spread facts, but also give my opinion on things and my perspective on things, because I was also inspired by Cheslie and her life and how she chose to treat people, how she carried herself. So this has been hard for me, and I didn't even realize the impact she had on me until she was gone. So I felt the need to do this, and excuse the hat indoors. Like, it's cold in here. So that's why I am shaky in my voice today, because it is cold in Ohio as usual. So forgive me on that, but yeah, I just really wanted to spread some information. So stick around. I'm going to be in this video talking about several things. The first thing I want to talk about is the title of this video, the misconceptions about Cheslie that have been spreading around since the 30th, almost a month. And there's been new rumors every single day since then. Number two, I want to share my perspective based on a therapist in training's perspective, because I am a therapist in training. So I'm very familiar with depression and the symptoms of depression, the symptoms of suicidality. So I know the signs, I know the symptoms and all of that. And high functioning depression needs to be at the forefront of discussion in my field, because there's not enough research out there. So having that conversation as well, if you guys want to have this conversation further in the comments, we need to do that, because we need to spread more awareness about high functioning depression and what it looks like and our experiences with it. Because a lot of us are and have been high functioning in a depression 20 kicked off. So another point of emphasis throughout this conversation is going to be scenarios. I am type A about scenarios. I need to have scenarios to make sense of things. I need to have scenarios to make things logical. when things are illogical, when things don't make sense, like this whole situation. And I'm sure the family agrees that this situation does not make sense at all. So the first thing I did was try to figure out scenarios, try to figure out clues, things that people just didn't pick up on. So I'm so cold, and it's just really annoying me because I'm shaking and we need more heat in this room. But so scenario one will be talking about the potential foul play that could have been involved in this situation, because of the surrounding facts, the conflicting facts, it's just conflicting. Like, I don't have any other word to say. Like, it's conflicting and it doesn't make sense what happened. It still doesn't make sense to me. I mean, every day it's getting better with understanding. And I can't even imagine what the family may be feeling, like how. And that's probably going to be a question for them for years. What else? Scenario two is what happened, you know, suicide and what could have caused her to want to end her life. And the things that I have picked up on as a therapist in training, that scenario will be played out, or I'll be talking about it. And I'm going to have videos of evidence of the things that I'm saying. I'm not just going to throw things out there. I'm going to have things to back it up with, to further this discussion, because one thing I want to say is that this family is going through so much right now, and it breaks my heart that her mother has to go through this right now, especially knowing that they were best friends, that they were so close, so connected. They talked every single day. And Cheslie gave proof of that through her day-to-day. When she would show us her day-to-day, she always would include her mother in that day-to-day. So I just cannot fathom or imagine what they must be feeling like. If I feel this way, if I feel like this doesn't make sense, or her life was just beginning in a sense, and it's heartbreaking for me to even talk about. So I can't imagine how her mother had the strength to go up there and talk for her family in that moment. All I can say is God has his hand over her life right now. And we can tell, because I don't know how she's functioning right now. So this video is no disrespect to them. I respect them. I respect their strength that they're showing right now. And it's just a way for us to further understand cases like this of high functioning depression and bring more awareness to it and investigate high functioning depression, what it looked like, what we missed, what we didn't see. And then also investigate all the scenarios of what could have happened. Just because it was deemed a suicide doesn't mean it should stop there. The investigation should stop there. And the person's life just doesn't get talked about again. We need to start investigating these suicides and get to the root of the problem. Get to the root of the problem of why they chose to end their lives. It just doesn't happen out of the blue. It takes a big decision, a string of events to come to the conclusion that you need to end your life. And the police need to take that into consideration in their investigation. And the life that Cheslie lived, the life that all the people that have taken their lives deserve to be investigated, to have their whole story out in the open of what was the root of them taking their lives, so that we can know how to prevent somebody doing that in the future. That's the problem with this world, in my opinion. We're just so quick to go to the next thing instead of understanding why it even occurred. So that's why I waited a month to even do this, because I know the people that still are watching and looking for videos for this actually do care. And it wasn't just a blip, a little story that they saw. They actually did care about Cheslie and want to know more about the situation now that the whole world has supposedly moved on. So moving forward, hopefully I can get a little warmer. And again, I'm praying for the family and their friends and her friends right now, because they need the most prayer at this moment. While the rest of the world is moving on, that's when families dealing with grief need all the prayers they need that they can get. Okay, so the next thing that I want to talk about is, you know, just a little background of how I felt about Cheslie and her life and her impact. I just remember first seeing her and being so captured by first her beauty, her confidence, but not only that, I saw myself in her. I was just saying not too long ago that when I saw her for the first time, I think it was on The Real. It was one of her first interviews for Extra on The Real. And I was like, wow, just hearing her talk and the way she carried herself just reminded me of myself and the way our personalities were similar. The way that we spoke was similar, especially in professional forums. The way that you have to articulate and be eloquent in your speech. I saw myself in her. It was like I saw her as an older version of me. I was the younger version of her, or something like that. Like, it was so crazy because our personalities were so similar. And I noticed and I could understand that she was a little nervous that day. And I get nervous all the time speaking in public places. And so her being transparent about that moment, she was like visibly nervous, and it was refreshing to actually see somebody be honest about that. And then come to find out on her TikTok, she would tell her viewers that the real moment of that moment, like basically a transparent moment of what she was actually thinking during these moments. And she played The Real clip back, And she revealed that she was nervous and that she was actually dealing with a terrible migraine that day, and that was like affecting her ability to speak that day. And I thought that was so real because I knew something was up that day when I was watching it. It was my first time ever seeing her speak. And I was like, something is going on with this girl, but I don't know what it is. But she's pushing through. That's what my thought was. She is pushing through whatever is going on. And that I have respect for that because that's exactly how I am in those moments. That's exactly what I'm doing right now, actually, because I'm shivering so hard, but I'm pushing through. So all that to say, like, I was very inspired by her. And from that first moment of seeing her on the reel, I made sure to find out how I could follow her on Instagram and follow her journey. And I was able to connect with her a few times on Instagram. And because we all know that Cheslie is like super humble, and she would try to respond to everybody when she could. And that just made me connect with her even more because she wasn't just about the fame. Like, we're always seeing people be just about, oh, you should be treating me this way because I'm on TV, or I make more money, or I don't know, I live this glamorous life, so you're supposed to come to me a different way. And I don't have time to speak to anybody else. She was never that way, and that's what I respected about her. And she was freaking gorgeous. She was beautiful. And it was the last time I saw her post on Instagram. I saw that last post on a story, on one of my friend's stories. And I was like, oh my God, that's Chesley. Beautiful as always. And I was like, oh my God, somebody knows who Chesley is just like I do. And the next part of the story was telling us that she had passed. And I was so like, no, like the first thing I replied on that story was no, there's no way. And I thought for sure that it would have been a crash, or it would have been, you know, the plane crash, like Kobe passed, or something else. Never in my wildest dreams would I have thought her life ended prematurely, voluntarily. And that's what stuck out to me to this day. Whatever scenario that we're going to be talking about, we do know for sure that she went over that building that day. And it still breaks my heart. Like, it's hard to even fathom that that's what happened. But I don't want to keep this too long for you guys. So let's get into the points of emphasis that I talked about early on in the video. So, fans' misconceptions, the things that I've been seeing, the misconceptions of Chesley's life or whatever, the rumors that I've been seeing. One, number one is that she's gay, that she was this lesbian that, you know, was in the closet and she couldn't come out the closet, so she took her life. And before I go through all these lists, I mean these rumors, I just want to say only God and Cheslie know the truth at this point. So if any of these are true, Lord forgive me. But for right now, we're just sticking to the facts. And what the facts say is that that's some bull. Okay, so again, the rumor was that she was gay and that Kaylee Garris was her partner. That doesn't even make sense. Number one, because Cheslie only talked about her being having a boyfriend or having a man in her life. She's only said that. She's advocated for the LGBTQ plus community multiple times. So she wouldn't have had any problems coming out. Her parents were very comfortable and cool, advocated for the LGBTQ community. So I don't know where that came from. And also, Kaylee has a boyfriend herself. And if you did any research, just watched a couple of videos of Kaylee herself. She's talked about her boyfriend and everything. And I'm sure she still has that boyfriend, that same boyfriend. So I don't understand that rumor at all. Kaylee Garris was Miss Teen USA 2019. Cheslie was her mentor, and they continue to have a great friendship up until her death. And she was in her one of the recent YouTube videos that Cheslie had uploaded. So it was so crazy. Like, y'all would not believe what I have came across on YouTube. Like, I have been in arguments with people that say that Cheslie used a PR stunt or something. No, she was like doing this PR thing about being straight out in public, but then being gay in private. And I was like, what? First of all, it's none of your business. And then two, why would she need to do that? People don't use PR people like that. Women especially don't use PR to keep their gayness under wraps anymore. That's just not a thing. Especially when you're young, like she was. What would be the point? What would be the purpose of her being in the closet? If you can tell me that, just let me know. Anyways, moving on. Another misconception that I have been seeing people talk about is that she was lonely in New York and that she was homesick. No. And I will be honest, I thought the same thing. So I don't blame you. But again, if you did your research, if you did watch a couple videos, there's plenty of videos that Cheslie did. Plenty. And I'm still watching them myself. She was super busy because she has so many videos. But if you watch a couple of them, you would know. And I'm going to show you guys that she said in one of her videos when she was getting cupcakes around New York or whatever, she was asked, do you ever get homesick? Do you ever get lonely? She says, and people probably watching this know that she was an introvert naturally. So she did not have a problem being alone. I can speak from experience because I'm also an introvert and I love to be alone. She says that she's an introvert naturally, and that also she doesn't get homesick that often because she's often at home. And she talks to her family every day, pretty much. So she was not homesick. And I'm pretty sure if she was, she would have taken a flight to see her mother and her family, like she always does. So that's false. And you can fact check that because she had just visited her family for the holidays. And also she did a whole YouTube video when she was in North Carolina with her sister Paige, when she transformed her hair. You can go back to that video on Cheslie's YouTube page. And she was just in North Carolina with her sister not too long ago. So she visited home frequently. So it wasn't like being in New York was just like terrible for her as far as being homesick or lonely. Sis has some friends. Sis had tons of friends that she was seeing. So don't even assume that. She was a-okay as far as people is concerned. Another thing, and this is one of the last ones that has really irked my soul when I see this rumor, that she never had a boyfriend and was wanting a man so bad that she had to end her life. So just say basically you've never seen Cheslie talk ever, or watch any of her videos or anything in particular. Just say that you never did any research if you're saying that, because sis did not need a man to keep on living. Trust and believe. Yes, sometimes as women, we do feel like the time is ticking. Sure. And we need to find a man soon. Sure. But one thing's for certain, she had a boyfriend. She's called him out, her ex out, many times before when they were together during her reign as Miss USA. And you can definitely check that out. I see there's another video of somebody exposing her ex-boyfriend, which I don't know why people are doing that. We should have just kept it in a group chat or something, because it's like, this is hard on him, I'm sure. And now he has his name attached to this in a brutal way. Like he is probably the reason that she is gone. Like, that's why I had to do this video, because like, no guys, she had a boyfriend. She had plenty of boyfriends. She was probably dating Mike Johnson, which I'm praying for him as well, because they were super close. Because they went on a vacation. You can go to his Instagram page now. It's still on there, that he shared with us that they went on vacation in July 2021 to Puerto Rico together. And I'm pretty sure they tried to figure out something as far as dating, because, you know, we're not going to go to Puerto Rico. We're not going to go out of the states, out of the country with a man if we're not at least thinking of where it could go. So, so sis didn't have no problems in the men department. She was getting DMs left and right from people, and comments left and right from celebrities that wanted to get with her. So that was never an issue. So she was just busy. Like, she probably just couldn't deal with another man and then do take over the world at the same time right now. So that wasn't a thing. Moving on. So don't ever assume like a woman would take her life because she doesn't have a man, especially not her. Like, that's so far from the truth. Okay, so moving on to the last section. Getting closer to the scenarios. Okay, I'm trying to keep it moving. Okay. From a therapist in training, I should say, in training perspective. So I'm very fresh in knowledge as far as symptoms, the DSM-5, diagnosis, all of it. So from my perspective in that regard, I have investigated this because she does not display the symptoms of a depressed person. That's obvious. A depressed person has trouble. Sorry about that. A depressed person has trouble getting out of bed, going and doing activities that they are used to doing. They have trouble functioning, taking showers, washing their hair. One thing's for certain, Cheslie did her hair every week, every day, probably, when she's on extra. That is for certain. So, moving on, some of the other symptoms. Just not having the motivation to do anything. Anything at all. And, oh my God, I'm so sorry. That was not the case with Cheslie. That was not the case. So I guess that does move us into high functioning depression, which is a new buzzword, because in, as I am in training in grad school right now, learning about depression and what entails somebody is in depression, what symptoms that they're showing and displaying. None of that, none of what Cheslie, who Cheslie was, is anywhere close to a depressed person, clinically depressed person, at all. And I'm concerned about that notion because we're not learning about high functioning depression. We're not learning about what that looks like and how to see it in a client, because I am aware that she actually did go to therapy. She's explained that she saw a therapist often to cope with the stress of Miss USA and the trolls that come along with that, or any issues that she may have been having. So she knew how to seek help. One of the key things that we are being taught to look for in a person is their ability to function, their coping mechanisms, the way they're interacting with others, or the lack thereof. their view of their self, their view of themselves. Are they insecure? Are they, do they have a negative self view of themselves? Those are things that we look at as far as depressed and suicidal patient clients. So those are the list of things that I was looking for when I went to investigate, as far as looking at Cheslie's videos in a different mindset now, in hindsight. And granted, yes, Instagram is full of games, full of facades, for sure. But one of the things that set Cheslie apart was that she was transparent at all costs. She did her best to be real, be a source of realness on a fake app. She was no stranger of telling us when she wasn't feeling good, or she didn't feel like she looked the best, or she felt like she gained weight. She was no stranger of telling us when she wasn't feeling herself, or none of that. Like, she told us how it was. Like, she never faked anything. Like, she had a whole video about being humbled throughout her whole entire life, and that never fazed her. So that's the area of confusion. She also talked about, and please, I encourage you to go and look at her IG lives, Instagram lives that she did during her reign as Miss USA with other Miss USAs or the pageant world, because she really shed light on who she was and her life, her perspective about her life. You could really tell what she was about, because you can't fake anything through IG Live. It's live and there's no editing that you can do. And they talked about real topics such as mental health, such as depression, for example. And she talked about one in particular that I remember is Olivia Jordan, that video. So I encourage you to watch that one. It was eerie in some places, and it was insightful, because one, she talked about her ability to have coping mechanisms. And that was something I kept trying to investigate. Did she have the right coping mechanisms that she could go to when she felt down or in despair? And she did. And she spelled it out. She said some of the things that she does was watch her favorite movies, watch her favorite shows over again, to unplug from social media for a while, to say no when she needs to say no to people. And that is a big thing. Like, people don't know how to say no, and so they spread themselves thin. And she recognized that she used to do that, and it wasn't good for her mental health. And she was aware of that. She was aware of that. So that's why I'm like confused, because how do we go from that? And she also talked about her spirituality. That's another thing we look at. Do you have anything that you believe in, you put your belief and faith in, that keeps you grounded during points of despair. And she had that as well. So, and she always talked about her faith in God and the plan that he had for her. And that she was good with the journey that he set, the path that he had for her. She was very clear on saying that. So people that are saying that she didn't have any faith in God because she wouldn't have done so, she had faith, a strong faith in God. So those are the things that makes this hard to believe that she would do. Because those are the things that we look at in a person that comes to us that is depressed or suicidal. We check for those things. So moving forward, that's why I was like, something's got to be up. And to be honest with you, I was one of those conspiracists or conspiracy theorists that was like, somebody did something and covered it up because this girl is not the one. Like, she doesn't just go out of the blue and do this out of nowhere. And I take mental health so seriously. Like, I'm literally in a profession, trying to be in a profession that advocates for mental health. So anyways, moving on. So I'm going to talk about the scenarios and then I'm going to get out of here. And because this is already too long. but she deserves it. And this is also a way for me to cope with this, because it definitely struck a chord in me, because it's like a part of me. Like, I saw myself in her. So like, now that she's gone, it's like, wow, that could have been me. So anyways, let me just keep going. Scenarios of what possibly could have happened to her, because things don't make sense to me. And this is where I try to piece things together. Okay, so bear with me. Please bear with me. I know some people are going to say, like, that's crazy, but I have facts. Okay, so scenario one is where foul play could have been involved. So one, I went back to the first moment that I realized that, you know, the news had broke that she passed away. I went to her page and tried to find answers. And what I found was she had a story, an Instagram story still up. Although she was gone from the world, she still had an Instagram story still up. And the story was her congratulating the new Miss Teen USA and the new, I think, North Carolina. The new Miss North Carolina. I'm pretty sure. And she had thanked the person that took the picture and sent her the picture, so that she could post it and be congratulatory to the winners. That was the last thing she had ever posted on her story. And I wish I would have took a screenshot of it so I could show you guys, but you can go on the current Miss Teen USA's Instagram page And she corroborates this story because she tells you that Cheslie had followed her and mentioned her in her story. And I bring that up because it tells us a little bit of the story of her activity the night before she passed. And she passed early on in the next day, in the morning. So keep that frame of reference. So we know that she was congratulating the Miss Teen USA, Miss US, Miss North Carolina USA in her last story. And that was a nighttime story. That was a night. It was that night. So the night of the 29th of January that she posted that. I have no idea if she posted something before that and it could have expired by the time I got to it. But that's the only thing that I remember that she posted the night before. Moving on, the second thing, Zosie, which she was Miss Universe 2019, I believe. You can look up on her page on Instagram, and she also said that she just had talked to Cheslie about a wedding that she was going to on that Saturday, January 29th. And that she was supposed to report to Zosie how it went, what she wore, a picture of what she wore, and give her all the tea on what happened at the wedding. So I say that to say she never got a chance to, I guess. I say that to say what happened at this wedding. When we think about what led up to a person to end their life prematurely, what led up to a person that took their life, we have to look at that. And I think the police and detectives need to look at that. What happened at that wedding? To my core, I was thinking something had to have happened at that wedding. That night after the wedding, something could have happened to Cheslie. And I'm sorry to bring up the 13 reasons why rhetoric of suicide, but it's a frame of reference in our pop culture of what leads somebody to take their life like that. When we think of somebody like Cheslie, who is the light of the room, who is confident, who is mentally tough and has shown she has the mental toughness to withstand judgment, to withstand comparison in a pageant world, the type of mental toughness you have to compete against other beautiful women, bar none. And just a person that was full of life. Needs to take their life. Something triggered that. Yes, you can have high functioning depression I have had high functioning depression myself. I have studied it recently because of what happened to Cheslie and my studies as a master's student. And what the research says is that high functioning depression is when you have multiple things at play in your life, such as, okay, for example, you're going through grief. You just lost someone. You just lost your mother or something like that. Your car is broke down because now you don't have any form of transportation that you can rely on. At home, you don't have a happy marriage. You have special needs kids that need your attention. All through that, you're still functioning through that dysfunction, the grief, the bad marriage, the energy it takes to care for a special needs child. But all through that, you still have that that smile on your face. You still show up to work somehow with a smile on your face. You're still going to church and being very active in the church and showing up and doing volunteer work. You're doing all of that. But yet, you're not recognizing that you are depressed because of what you're going through, what you're putting your body and your mind through. That is high function. That's the picture of high functioning depression. You have a lot going on. You don't have a social support system. You don't have the family to go to and to call. And so bringing that story back around to Cheslie and not downplaying that she could have been having so much stress that could have been happening in her life. I have no idea. But what I do know is what her mother said, and that she said that she talked to Cheslie every day and she did not notice any change in her happiness. And this is her mother that she has shown that she has been down. She's been in despair, in moments of despair, and her mother has picked her up and she's explained that she's not feeling her best to her mother before. So what was the difference now? So that tells me it was something that she experienced that could have been traumatizing, that could have triggered a part of her depression where she could not function anymore like she was. It takes a trigger, especially if you're high functioning, to trigger you into suicide. You don't just walk up one day and say, oh, I'm finally like done and can't bear my stress today, and I just can't understand that, especially knowing that she had a supportive family. She had supportive friends, something that a lot of people don't have. And granted, yes, you can still be depressed and have all the external things and not feel like you have the internal factor together. Totally sympathize with that. But what I'm saying to you in this scenario, I feel that something triggered what happened. another point of emphasis of in this scenario, I'm sorry, I need to wrap it up, but another thing was her TikTok. The last time she posted on her TikTok was the 27th, I believe. And she was like super active on TikTok before she passed, which is not normal at all for somebody that wanted to end their life and was planning to end their life. A person that had just started a YouTube channel. A person that worked out every day because she knew that working out helped her mind feel healthier. She said that with her own words. A person that before she posted her last Instagram post said that her January workouts were working. A person that was just talking about the projects that they had coming up in this summer with a friend and did the work for it not too long ago. And granted, yes, through all that, you can very well still want to end your life through all of that. I understand that. But you have to have a reason. One thing about 13 Reasons Why, it tells you there was 13 reasons why this girl, why Hannah wanted to end her life. And that one reason is crazy. 13 reasons, but there was one reason why she could not take it anymore. And what was that? Bryce assaulting her and taking away the power that she was birthing within herself. Because people forget this, but she was in a more confident state. She was getting herself back. She was turning the corner, Hannah of 13 Reasons Why. And then that one thing turned her whole journey around and triggered her to want to kill herself. So what I'm saying here is you gotta look a little deeper in this case than just clearly saying, oh, high functioning depression and she just took her life. Oh well. You have to have something that depresses you. You have to have something that triggers you into killing yourself, especially if you're high functioning. High functioning means that you're functioning through a depression and you're okay with it. A lot of Black women have this diagnosis and don't even know it because we're always taught to be strong. We're always taught to push through, keep it pushing, keep it moving through everything that we're going through in front of us. So I definitely do not downplay high functioning depression. That's not what this is about. But in this scenario, there are things that are conflicting the storyline and that are not being talked about. So, I might have to do a part two because this is too long. Oda, I will be back for a part two. And I think I have a couple more points on this scenario of foul play. And then the next scenario will be what actually probably transpired and how it could have transpired through what we know, through the facts, through what she's given to us while she was alive. Okay, so stay tuned for the next video.